Niles, we have to show the people some stuff.
We're just going to interrogate you all.
Yeah. You're all along. Hey, Sterling, you got something? What? No? We're waiting for something.
No Top Gun.
Where's on Top Gun?
I saw the house outside.
You did, right? You were there.
I drove by it.
Yeah.
Why is it here?
Everyone wants a selfie of you in front of that house, by the way. But anyway, tonight was super awesome. We were just, I mean, come on, 20 years. Sold house, but a little rain did not keep all of you anywhere. You're here. Everyone is, this is an exciting night for us. It's our opening night, and it's, we crushed 20 years. I don't think I'm good at stalling, though. Okay. I'm Carly Starr, and I'm one of the people that help run this Oceanside Intl.
What else? Lady
of
Blue Crush.
Oh, I was assistant prom master of Blue Crush.
Yeah.
I also did Crazy Beautiful with. it's going to be awesome pulling out the old cruise sheet and calling up some people. And beautiful people showed up with their bells on, and we couldn't be happier. It's super exciting. So, are we ready, Sterling? Okay, 1 more minute. A fascinating fact that you don't know about John is, did you go to Harvard?
I attended Harvard. I attended Harvard when I graduated, but I didn't say I went there. I was already an actor by the time. It's a hard school to get into, it's a really hard school to get kicked out of. So yeah, I did go.
You are the triple threat. I mean, you started off as a model. You know what I mean? That's pretty impressive. I couldn't believe it. I didn't know that. I didn't know that Harvard thing. So. But anyway. So.
Yeah, I'm not a surfer. I wasn't a surfer.
You're before. A
surfer. Oh, thank you, Sanoe. Sanoe is a surfer. Yeah. Sanoe is the person that. Sanoe was the only. I mean, honestly, the best thing about seeing this. And 20 years is realizing that we just did have a women's pipeline program.
Yeah.
And that was, it shouldn't have taken 20 years, and it's too bad Keala didn't compete on the competition.
No.
But Manoa Jones, like Coco Ho, who played a young Kate, she competed, I believe.
Yeah, we have a couple of clips from Rochelle, who was there, and Keala. It's pretty exciting. It is, they were flying, they were really excited. It was kind of.
I mean, the most amazing thing that I learned about pipelining, because going out there even as a director on a surfboard who couldn't really surf, is at the end of every, whenever we were done filming, the Keala's and all the Hoovy guys would be like, okay, this is John's way. And they'd be like, no, I don't want this way. No, this is John's way. Everyone sit back. And then I would take off and I would eat shit. Didn't die. But the great thing, the scariest thing about being in a pipe in a contest is you got to take off because there's not a crowd. Normally there's 300 people out and you can just come in and say, so crowded I couldn't get away.
So ladies and gentlemen, John Stockwell is here. We had an intro made, I don't know. This is crazy, right, John?
Control, you girl, it's well. Okay, that's the moon and I'm a love zone.
Why are you retarded on that? And ladies and gentlemen, we have Kate Bosworth here tonight. Yeah. Sanoe. And I would like to bring Jessica Trent up here from Billabong. We all just flew there, but before you landed, how much work was into it before you got to Hawaii? I mean, did you have Brian on board? How did you pitch this to the studios? And they said, sure.
No, I didn't pitch it. Brian and Imagine had option to sue the Orleans article called Surf Girls Maui, set by an Outside magazine, I think, and it was set in Hana. It was a small coming-of-age story about girls who surf in a small town and want to get off the island. There was no competition, there was no surf contest. And that's how I developed it with Lizzie Weiss. It was a small coming of age movie. And Brian was very macro. I was like, okay, at one point he's talking, he's like, so who wins the contest? I'm like, Brian, there is a contest. He's like, this is a sports movie, there has to be a contest. And at first, you know, we were like, okay, that's kind of cliche. But of course he's right, because that's what propels the movie forward,
and
while we were trying to do a smaller character-driven piece that just was about girls girls who were in paradise but hated,
you know, and wanted to leave, and then it morphed into a studio movie. When I watch this tonight, the most I take away is all the things we did that the studio hated. We shot a lot of the surf contest, the last final act, during a costume wardrobe test. Because I knew that there was gonna be a big swell in December, the crew wasn't there yet. The universe was like, you can't shoot, we don't have insurance, we don't have wardrobe. And I was like, well, we'll do a wardrobe test, but we'll just shoot it in the water. And there happened to be a big wave. The scene where they're walking through the crowd on the beach, that's the real pipe masters. And we just put up those lines, if you were here, you know, you can set to be on camera. Her that, like, oh, it's safe. And she was like, it's safe? It doesn't seem safe.
Yeah.
Okay. And she would just get over feathering waves, and I'd be like, oh, okay, we almost lost her. And before we had water safety, before we had jet skis, any assistance, we were literally just freestyling it. And Universal was not.
What's amazing about your career, I always love, is your ability to write. You are an amazing writer. You have a few Rockstar, that movie you did, and Breastman. You've done some amazing
things. Yeah, well, they're all based on nonfiction. Rockstar was a New York Times article. Breastman was a Texas Monthly article. So I don't consider myself a writer, but I do consider myself to be a listener and a recordist of what I. The same thing with Hawaii. I think we went over there, a lot of the people in it, from Kala to Kiteboard to just all the people I saw, like secondary characters, who probably never made another movie. They really add to the character.
They really do. I mean, did you finish the script? There were a lot of rewrites, right? Because did you guys learn?
The whole script was different.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. It was called Super Girls. The working title.
Super Girls.
Yeah. I mean, Kate, when you held that in your hand, the script, and you were going to audition, is it Anne-Marie that she speak to you? Did you speak to her? Were you warriors? Because it became an international language that so many people understood. What part of her is you and your her?
I mean, I think this is probably the role in which I felt most intertwined with the character. I had just moved to LA from a small town outside of Boston. I deferred from college. I deferred from Princeton, and I moved out to LA to try and be an actor, and I thought I'd give myself 1 year to, you know, just to see what happened. And this was in 2001. So
it was around 2011.
Yes, exactly. And all anything that I was reading was sort of like, it was very vapid, sort of dumb blonde roles, and yes. It was you know, we've come a long way now, but then it was even more dire for women, for actresses, and this script came to me, and I just felt like I knew I had never touched a surfboard. Which we'll get to. That was a very interesting part of how I got this role. But I did understand what it felt like to have a dream and to be very determined and to be very hardworking and to have doubts and to have fears and to understand what it felt like to have the sort of wherewithal, the grit to overcome that, yes. You know, and I mean, I was 18 when I did this movie.
Yeah, so, sure. Yeah.
I was just fresh out of high school, really. And I went to just a small public school. So this was, you know, very, very honest, actually. I see myself in this movie and think there's a lot of myself in that girl. I just was trying not to die most of the time. I watched this movie.
It's true.
Oh God. People sometimes ask me, were you afraid of sharks? And I was like, no. I wasn't thinking of sharks. I was just thinking of the 30-foot waves behind me at all times.
Even when we'd stand in 3-foot water, it'd knock us over. It was the craziest power you could ever feel.
And Kate is very focused. I mean, I honestly, when she came in, I was like, okay, this girl, great actress, she's never going to be convincing as a pro surfer, you know? And she went in between the time she read for us, and knowing that she was like on top of the pack, she went, and I think you just took surf lesson after surf lesson, worked out, yeah. And built up her upper body strength. Because all I said, I think, to any of the people was, I just want you to be able to paddle. You know, yeah. I just want you to be able to paddle out there, because if you can't paddle, you're probably going to die, because the ski won't get to you, the lifeguard, your water safety won't get to you. You need to, and it also looked convincing.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
we knew that, I mean, let's be honest, she wasn't surfing 20-foot pipeline, but she was paddling through 20-foot sets at pipeline, which is pretty amazing.
That's amazing.
It was amazing to witness. I mean, isn't her character, didn't she just bring that to life? Like, it is, I mean, truly, it's so many people's favorite character. I mean, you had me at Horse Whisperer, but bottom line, I mean, how are you?
I tried to convince John do you remember this? When you said, well, can you surf? When I was auditioning, and I was like, well, no, I said no, because I really thought, I really should be honest, which is the biggest mistake I had to make as an actor. But I did say to him, but I can ride horses. Like, I'm a show jumper. And he was like, that doesn't help at all. And I was like, I said, I know what it's like to fall. I mean, I fall on ground. I can fall in water, you know?
I mean, my idea was, I'm going to hire all real surfers. Yeah. It was going to be Holly Beck and Cassie Metter. We had a lot of like young surfers that it just came close. Like, they were decent. But then Brian, to his credit, was like, you need to find an actress and teach them how to surf, because if you do the surfer
turned actress thing or a surfer turned actor, it's that's very challenging. So we, you know, aside from Sanoe, who has managed to do surfer actress, she was the anchor that kept the surfing solidified.
Because there you were, Sanoe, you were base of, you know, Roxy and just a very amazing surfer.
But she's more than a model. She's a really good surfer.
She really was. I mean, I was getting to that. And it was, what did you think? It was really important for you to keep, I imagine holding that script, it was very important for you to keep it real, like you wanted to represent, you know?
100%.
So that must have been interesting for you to read the script.
So when I read the original script, I wasn't really that interested, but I thought it would be fun to do a movie because I was a surfer. So I was like, oh, this might be kind of cool, but like the script is horrible. And then there was this like, but it, you know, it morphed and stuff, but the original, there were a lot of lines. No, it wasn't. So there were just some lines that we wouldn't normally say, like, let's go rip some barrels, wahines and stuff or whatever. But that was just coming from a super core surfer perspective. And then as I got into it and saw like how the process went, you got to meet in the middle. And, you know, I just kind of took the journey and thought I'm a very, you know, kind of go with the flow person. And I believe if a door opens, just walk through it and see. So, you know, but coming from the surfing industry, obviously, like as a kid, you know, you kind of have a little ego involved and like you want to be a part of something that's going to be good. Because in Hollywood, like the films can go on and then you go back to your industry and they're like, oh, you did that film that like, you know, wasn't good. And so I did, you know, when I looked at it originally, I was kind of, you know, thinking, is this something that I really want to do? I was kind of scared and nervous, but I kind of really wanted to try to do a movie. And walking through the doors and getting to work with John and Brian, who were so committed to doing something authentic to the culture, which is really, really hard to do in surf. And when I look at this film, and every single person that I've ever talked to that's watched it is like, I just love this film. And I have to credit John and Brian. Yes. Wanting to make this thing authentic. And, you know, when John was saying like, oh, you know, I kind of like, you know, just like, we're going to shoot it this way. You know, everyone just called it guerrilla style. Yes. Cause they're like, John's just guerrilla style. He's just going to go and he's going to get it done however he needs to. And it was so like the Vulcan party was a real Vulcan party. That was a real Vulcan party. They threw a sign up and they were like, if you're here, you're being filmed. And that was truly, I mean, I grew up out in Hawaii and on the North Shore and that's a Vulcan party. That's what they look like. It's exactly how it is. And then, you know, Kate, coming on was so full of grit and so determined to just get the surfing thing down. And I was so impressed with her because a lot of people that don't grow up in the ocean and get out into the North Shore, like the North Shore's ocean is different. Hawaii's ocean in general is just different. I don't know if there's any surfers in this room that has actually surfed in Hawaii, but you know, like the water out there is different than
it's alive.
And I remember the first day we flew out there and we went to Waimea Bay and they were like, we just want to get Kate in the water and see how she does with how it moves.
And it was breaking.
And we were, but it was just surging. And you just get out there and she did so well, but you could see, I mean, everything, when I watch this film and I see your emotion and I see everything, it's so real. It's so real. Like, I look at it, and I was like, gosh, this is such an amazing role for her because you just see everything on your face. I mean, it was the same emotion I saw that first day when you got in that water and you're like, and I was like, you good? And you're like, yeah. And she would just say, yeah, even though she was terrified inside, she just rose to the occasion. It was really incredible to see. So yeah, the film, the authenticity that John and Brian and every single person that was on the film were committed to was just incredible. So I'm very, very proud to have been able to be a part of something like this because I went in kind of dipping my toe in the water and unsure, and I kind of just kept walking through the doors. But Universal really, truly just wanted nothing to do with me.
Do you remember?
And John and Brian fought for me because they were like, who's this girl and what? And what if she gets on this film?
You were
and like bombs. And they were just like, no, you got to meet her. She's great. And somehow, by the grace of God, I got to be a part of this amazing film. So I'm very grateful.
Well, you almost didn't do it.
Yeah.
What's that about?
Do you remember walking around the parking lot? You were like, everyone keeps following me. Wait, what are we?
I don't know if you're... I mean, the one thing I also have to give credit to, and when they talk about authenticity and feeling comfortable, is we had like the most amazing water photographers, Don King, Sonny Miller, Dave Holmesy.
Yes. And Sonny's from here.
Yeah, Sonny's no longer with us. Sonny was our announcer, amazing water photographer.
He was amazing.
But you know, the Kaelanas, even Mike Stewart, like this is a great example. Mike Stewart, a champion bodyboarder, body surfer. We had all these IA Teamster, not Teamsters, but IA camera guys who'd be like, I can handhold, I can walk into the shore break. And they would go out with the camera, steady cam, and they would hit, you know, get literally knee deep and get knocked over, and they would lose a $300,000 camera. Mike Stewart was like, give me the camera.
Yeah.
And he would paddle out. He didn't know anything about cinematography, or he's never been a camera operator, but he knew how to get that perfect spot at in the water.
Yes.
And that was the kind of people we relied upon to score, you know, because they weren't in the union, Universal. Again, it was like a lot of fighting. Most of my other thing was like, why are there 30 people on the beach handing Kate a towel when she gets out? Can we save that money and get an extra 2 weeks of shooting? And they were like, no, it's a union thing. You need this many.
Because even the rigging alone, the boats, you know, it's 20 years ago. It was a whole different ball game. I mean,
we didn't have any digital. We didn't have GoPros. We didn't have
no green screen.
They tried CG. Universal had a separate unit. I don't know if you even knew this. They spent $2 million doing virtual, trying to do virtual waves and water, and it failed. So none of that's in the movie. There's some face replacement, like to be totally honest, that's not very good because it was in the very early days.
How did you feel being out in those boats? I mean, how did you feel?
I never was on a boat because I never felt safe in a boat.
Right.
Kate, you go. You go on the
journey. No, I mean, I'd be on a surfboard. I felt safe because I could abandon the board and go underwater. But in a boat, in pipeline, you don't want to be in. We had some jet boats and they...
No, I meant when you would shoot, they're rigging the camera department and there was all types of...
Everything was pretty simple. Everything was like a guy who was Don King swimming around with on a boogie board and a camera. It was not... We tried gimbal mounts and there was some of that, but it didn't really work. The more technology we tried to bring into that world, it just generally failed.
Hey, John, whose idea was it to have us all live together? Was that your idea? I think it was your idea.
It was in many ways a bad idea.
No, wait, we had the best time. I mean,
you guys really helped each other out. But
meeting Michelle Sanoe and I actually lived together on Sunset Beach for shooting the entire
movie. Yeah, they had a house.
In real life.
Do we have that ready, Angela?
Oh, no.
We didn't have iPhones back then.
Thank God there's no iPhones.
We have the intro Instagram clip.
Yeah. We're kind of similar to a character.
I mean, the person we are maybe going to hear from, Michelle Rodriguez, amazing person. Talk about someone who was fearless in the water and got her ass kicked.
And like, she just kept...
She really didn't know what she was doing. I mean, she came out
sometimes
like...
She just
wanted
to be on the jet ski.
But she went out like...
I wish I were there with you guys. I really miss that vibe, man. Can you believe how long it's been? Almost 20 years. Anyway, I really love the energy, you know? John, Sanoe, Kate, Carly. I haven't seen any of you in so long. I don't know. I think it would be really, really cool to shoot another Blue Cross. Oh, I don't know. I miss the water. I miss Hawaii. Anyway, I love you guys, and I hope you have an amazing panel, and I send you lots of love and light. And it's a magical day, man. Let's put it out there in the ether. Another freaking Blue Crush, baby. Anyway, lots of love, guys. Bye.
Yeah. And Jessica, what did you think when you got that script? Well, what happened with Billabong? Susan Matheson sends her love.
Susan Matheson was
a wardrobe designer.
She's an artist. She's a wardrobe designer, and she was incredible. We became very close behind the scenes, Christmas Eve phone calls, me pulling favors with the warehouse guys at Billabong and the sewers. But honestly, when I read the script, so I was the marketing director for Billabong for the women's division, which was, you know, sort of, they felt obligated to have a women's division at that time. They called it the girls, and it was like, you know, the ads looked like 1950s Crest commercials with smiling, and, you know, so I was really fighting a lot for the things that John also fought for with Blue Crush. I was fighting for that in my role. I was fighting, you know, using the system to help the women's cause, to bring in more diversity, to support girls and women all over the country, because I was in charge of domestic. But when I read that script, no one at Billabong read it. They didn't care to read it. I read it. I mean, I think it was a couple edits in, and I knew it was going to be a success. The Billabong bros were very skeptical. Yeah, it was a beautiful thing to see, again, as Kate and Sanoe talked about, the authenticity that John and Brian, I mean, especially John, really fought for. Keala Kennelly, obviously, you know, the heroine of the movie, the icon that the characters look up to, you know, I mean, As Sanoe and I were talking, every time in the contest scene with Kate, I get teary every time, because that really is who Keala is. And I knew her to do that in contests before. And I'd be like, what are you doing? You have to like win, you know? So, but that really is, that speaks to who Keala is. And, you know, again, I think just for this, the time, 20 years ago, which is insane, this movie was ahead of its time, you know. John also didn't let the, you know, wouldn't allow the actresses to wear makeup, and, you know, I just really appreciated that they were
going in the water.
No, I know, but
it's kind of stupid.
No, but
we had,
like, the Hollywood thing is
a huge makeup team. I was like, guys, right. You're putting sunscreen on them. Like, why do we have such a big makeup?
But I think it also keeps you engaged in the film, because to this day, I'll watch something and I'm watching a movie and, you know, they're out on a farm or whatever, and the actress wakes up on her pillow. And, you know, you're like, what? It takes you out of the moment. So I feel like you really stay in the moment. You feel like you are connected to this film. And I think there were so many, you know, true artists involved in this process. And I feel like it's a love letter to the North Shore. It's a love letter to surfing. And, you know, John helped create this family that we're all still connected and feel this bond to this day. And that is extremely rare in this life. So I really appreciate
that. And I have to echo the comments about Keala, because when I was out shooting, she would, like, when we weren't shooting, she would take off on a bomb and then be like, well, what are you doing? We got to get that on camera. She was like, and she would eat. I mean, I've never seen someone get pounded. Like, she could, and she'd just come up laughing. And the problem was, she's goofy, Kate's regular. Because originally I needed, like, who's going to double Kate? Who can surf pipeline? And Rochelle Ballard, amazing surfer too, but not as comfortable at pipe as
a specific way.
Yeah, like Keala is one of the few girls who surfed it regularly.
And what about Rochelle?
No, Rochelle was Kate's double. She got hurt a couple of times, and I mean, I hate to even acknowledge it, but at one point, I think it's pretty public known that Noah Johnson.
Yeah, donned a wig.
Donned a wig. Like, at one point.
Right, but that was for a hot minute. The rest of the.
Yeah. For one bit. We had a period where we couldn't get anyone. And we're like, any guys want to go out and shave their legs and put on a wig? And everyone's like, no, that's wrong. And then Noah was like, I'll do it. And he went out and caught a bomb. And everyone was like, I'll do it. I'll do it too. Like, they're all lining up. It was like way too late. It was a terrible winter on the North Shore too. I remember that. Like 22 was a terrible winter. It was like there was 4 days of good waves, and
then they were
a lot of the guys, because we got a small window during Mike Stewart's, during a contest.
A contest?
But, yeah, during a contest. It was like they gave us like 6 hours.
Something. I don't even
think. No, we had like 6 hours that they would let us film. And it was a very small window because you can't technically permit the North Shore. You can't permit really anything for filming and keep anyone out. But in the days when DeHuey and Eddie Rothman and those guys kind of regulated, they would tell the Brazilians, like, you guys, Kate's going to get this, you know, and they'd be like, no, I'm going to get it. And then they would drop it on Kate, and then something would happen to them later. And then they realize, they're like, oh, okay, I guess I got
to.
Yeah. It's very dangerous because you can get hurt. You know, my husband came to see me on set, and he's just going to go out and surf. And Brock Little was like, he what? And I'm like, he just went, and he's going to get killed, man. And Brock went, ran and got him, because it's serious stuff, because you can harm another surfer if you're not experienced enough.
It's chaos. I mean, it's mostly chaos there. So yeah. We were really trying to, Kate was literally in the lineup and paddling.
That's so nuts. That was so nuts.
The center,
like when I look at the film, I'm like, that's so nuts.
So
chaos. Like in hindsight,
I'm like,
so stupid.
Yeah. I mean, my biggest thing was I had seen North Shore, and I always hated that. I mean, great movie, but I didn't like that the leads would be out and it looked flat all around and there was no white water anywhere, and then they would turn around to be stock footage, would be like a 20-foot wave. So I was like, at the very least, I'd like to see some spray coming off the back of the waves when it's blowing offshore, or like, let's put them into the lineup.
Kate over the wave right before it takes her over the falls. Like, what the last
thing,
like, launch her over, she might die and go over the falls, but it's fine, we'll get the shot.
Don't we have something else? Okay, let's let her rip.
Keala Kennelly here, and I'm down here at Pipeline, which is where we filmed Blue Crush, right over there, which was honestly one of the funnest experiences of my life. We got to spend like 3 months cruising on the beach when the waves are good. They'd have us go out and surf pipe, and then we'd come in and have like epic craft service. It was just the coolest experience, and we had such an amazing crew. Kate Bosworth and Michelle Rodriguez and Sanoe, who was like one of my, Sanoe Lake, she was like a friend of mine since we were little kids. Also Jessica Trent, who was a really good friend of mine, and Rochelle and Megan. We just had such an awesome crew. We had such an amazing time. So anyways, I hope you guys enjoy the film as much as I enjoyed making it.
This is Rochelle Ballard and Megan Abubo. Just wanted to add to the stories of Blue Crush. One thing that stands out to me is when Meg was towing me into waves, big waves on the North Shore in one of the outer reefs. And it was a beautiful glassy day, and all the boys were there and the film crew. And we were just out the back talking story, and all of a sudden we're like, oh, look, here comes a little bump. Let's go on this one. And then all of a sudden it turned into a really big bump. And it ended up being a really big wave, and you know, the thing was barreling behind me, and it was just this really cool experience. And then I just remember like them all of a sudden throwing Michelle Rodriguez behind the ski and having her whip me in to see if she could do it. And you know, she doesn't surf, and so it was a trip having her whip me into waves. And I just remember getting like nailed by some big bombs and her towing me in a little bit too slack with the rope, and the wave broke over my head, and you know, they got the shot that they're looking for. What do you remember about Blue Crush that stokes you out?
Almost drowning with Mike Stewart out of Avalanche. They told me to, hey, well, besides that, that was cool. We got to tow it. I think the wave was like 20 feet that I towed you into. That was pretty amazing because we didn't have any life vests, or we were in good hands, but I'll never forget when they're like, oh, we're gonna go out to Avalanche and just jump off the ski. Oh, actually, crash the ski with Mike. He's gonna be in the water. You just fall off, and it's like 10 feet. And yeah, just swim towards the ski.
Right.
And I was like out there with the human dolphin. So it was pretty crazy. We had like 2 stunt coordinators with us. It was nuts.
It was the first time that we were learning how to tow, too. Like all the experiences that we had were, a lot of them were first times, even though, you know, we're kind of always surfing bigger North Shore.
Yeah, and I don't think we even realized the consequences of having no personal life vests.
Right.
And how big it really was. Like, I think about it now and I'm like, wow, well, if one of those, if I would have like lost control of the ski, which I almost did on this one big one, that big one you caught, I thought, yeah. I don't know if I could have survived a 20-foot wave landing on my head at the time. With no vest or
exactly. And then the one that Michelle towed me into and the rope was all slack, I got worked on it and my whole vest, it was just a wetsuit top, ripped off of me. And I actually didn't have a top on. And I remember Kai coming to pick me up and I'm like, that's okay. I'm just gonna take this one on the head because yeah. I don't have a top on. He's like, just get on the back of the sled. Yeah, we experienced a lot of really amazing moments in the pioneering of women's big wave surfing in just a really, innocent form, like naive really, and with no hesitation. And I think a lot of it was because we had a whole crew surrounding us, the wipeouts were guaranteed to happen.
Yeah, I thought that one of the coolest things about that shooting that movie was actually watching the live surfing at Pipe go down with some of the wipeouts like that Kate Scarrett had.
Yeah.
They weren't like rehearsed, they were just, she wiped out. It was pretty crazy. I don't know, it just seemed like real time all the time. Whenever you were filming, whether or not it was with Don King, Mike yeah. Stewart, whoever you were filming with, it just was very real, and it's kind of how it is, like even the underwater shots. I think the cinematography really made that movie.
It was amazing, and actually I didn't even think about it until just now, but I remember when they took Kate Bosworth out the back at real pipe. It was like 10 feet out the back.
It was huge.
And they had her paddling like in the, you know, not the impact zone, in a safe area.
Because we were paddling in the same spots.
Yeah, it was still for real. Like, she was right there in the lineup. And, you know, to put her in that situation, pretty wild.
And you know what? Probably the coolest thing about coming out of that whole generation of when we did that 20 years mm-hmm. ago or what, was after that, I mean, although it sounded so cheesy and cliche, it was like, oh, here's Blue Crush. Like, no matter what, like, if you just had more than three women in the lineup, you know, so we were always just the only women in the lineup until yeah. that movie pretty mm-hmm. much. And then it would be like, oh, Blue Crush. So it was kind of cool that like history, that whole history of, you know, women surfing, really it just started that boom. So.
Yeah, for sure. The very beginning stages of all of it, paving the road and pioneering, and look at where it is today. So enjoy, aloha.
Did you ever think, John?
Good job.
Who did those?
We
did.
Are they
just self-taped?
Carly.
Well,
Carly,
yeah.
Did you direct that?
Carly.
Oh, that was
no,
cool.
No, she did that with, she had a hard time. It was funny. She had to empty her phone and all that. And then that turned out to be the best. And then, yeah, it was great. And then my crew, we had.
I mean, I've heard that a little bit, like, oh, yeah, it was like Stockwell. Now there's all these girls paddling out of Pipeline with their pink boards and they got Blue Crush. I was like, you can't paddle out of Pipeline with your, you can't get out of Pipeline. So you have to be very skilled to even make it in the lineup, and you're going to get sent to the beach very quickly if you don't know what you're doing. But it's great to see more girls everywhere. I don't know why anyone would ever complain about that.
Those boards were a thing that we did with JC.
The film definitely.
Yeah.
The film definitely changed the amount of women in the lineup, which I found refreshing. I welcomed it. I thought it was really great because growing up, I remember it would be like maybe me and possibly one other friend out in the lineup, which Keala and I grew up on Kauai together and we were best friends growing up and surfing together. And it would be like the two of us and then the rest was all boys. And then after this film came out, I think it showed a lot of females that they could get out there and try it too, and it wasn't so intimidating, and it made it fun, and it made it feminine, and it also made it, it showed you could do it on a very high level, but also you could go out and, like, you know, we taught football players and they, you know, just went out and had fun. And so I think the film, what was, you know, a big part of the success of the film, I think, was that it was about three girlfriends, and so it made it approachable. which is, it's really hard. It's really, really hard to do a successful surfing Hollywood film. And because of John and Brian's commitment and dedication to wanting to keep it authentic, I think that's why they really hit it out of the park. And I think having the feminine aspect to it was what really made it digestible for a lot of people. And we was able to be like, you know, we were able to tap into the sensitivity and the emotions, because with dudes out in the lineup, it's just like, bro, just go, like, don't be a pussy, you know? And it's like, and these girls, it's like, you got this, and you could show her, you know,
yeah,
Anne-Marie's vulnerability in the film. And that really came through. I mean, you did such an incredible job at communicating that. So
I thank great. You. But we also, I feel like, you know, our relationship, myself and yours and Michelle's, it was as you see it in the movie.
100%.
I mean,
yeah. The idea of having us all live yes. together, that bond really did come through on screen, because we were just, I mean, we were literally like that at home. We were like, we were with each other 24 hours a day for like 3 months.
Yes.
I mean, we were up, I mean, to the point I'd be banging on Michelle's door. I mean, they gave me the super fun task of waking Michelle up every morning.
Well, I was
getting her to set on time.
I think Michelle was the one who was maybe out later than
anybody. Oh yeah, Michelle would be out very late. And then I mean,
there were good things and bad things about having you live together. You were good influences on each other, and you certainly stood up for each other. But you also, you were almost like a union. Like, there were times they were like, you know what, we're done, we're not. Because it's colder than people think surfing on the North Shore in the winter. So they would be...
And the black
they would just be
dress.
Like, I'm done. And I was like, well, then I guess. And then all three go in together.
We're
or,
done. Like,
or they would come in and be like, we don't like this, or we don't like that. And Brian was like, okay, this is a bad idea.
The black dress. Remember, Kate, the black dress scene? It was so cold.
Oh
my gosh. And everyone's like, how do you warm Kate? How do you warm? Like,
I remember we had sort of heaters in the water.
Yes.
They were trying to heat.
Oh, yeah, they had buckets of warm water.
Yeah.
When you got out on the beach.
Yeah,
when
we get up, jump in.
That's all I could think about in that scene, was just how cold it was.
Okay, we have a mic. We have a few more minutes left. If anyone would like to ask a question. Oh, you would like to ask a question?
Awesome. Thank you. Excuse me, I'm kind of emotional because this has been a favorite movie of mine for 20 years, and I'm fans of all of yours, but Kate, I'm a huge fan of yours, so it's an honor to be in front of you right now. I don't even, I'm 36 now, and so watching the film as an adult, I have different questions and I see different things, and so I don't even know who to ask this question to, because as I was watching the film, and you know, John, I'm also a huge fan of Crazy Beautiful. It's so interesting right now how Kirsten Dunst is getting her Oscar nomination for Power of the Dog. I'm like, no, Crazy Beautiful, go back. So it kind of ties in, because now when I watch the movie, one of the things that strikes me is, I mean, I guess you address it in the scene with Anne-Marie and with Michelle's character, but I never really felt that there was like validation for Anne-Marie's accident and sort of like understanding the trauma that she went through with almost dying. And so maybe that's something that I pick up on because I'm disabled. And I understand that, but that, like, that's just never addressed, and it just seems like, oh, you should be over it, that's nice, get back in the water. And I was just wondering if, like I said, I don't know who to ask that question to specifically, but if anyone wants to speak to what you thought about that, if you thought it should be addressed, did you address it privately, whatever you want to say about it. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, and thank you for... saying kind words. You mean, did it seem glib to have people just telling her, like, just get over it? Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yeah, like Michelle's character reminds me of people in my life. You know, when things have happened, I have a birthday, and I have had multiple things happen to me. And when one more thing happens, you're like, just come on, just get over it, just move on, it already happened. And it's like, that's traumatizing.
I I mean, that's very perceptive, and it's probably part of the Hollywood mythology to always have the best friend just saying, you know, go do it. And I guess we, I mean, it'd be so hard. It'd be so, it, the original movie was closer to like what the real world is, which is like, you have to know when to pull back from things and when to decide, you know what? I don't want to paddle back out of pipeline. You can die there. And yeah, it's a rush, but it's not worth doing. And, but that wasn't the movie that, you know, Universal wanted to make. And so, we did, the original movie was so small. It was really about someone just making a decision to leave their hometown. That was it. And it turned into this, which again, I get how it's, to a lot of people, it's inspiring and empowering. And to a lot of people, it's just, I mean, it's kind of, not to denigrate my own movie, but it's kind of bullshit. You know, like very few people can surf pipeline. So to tell anyone, like, just go back out there, I would never do it. So I get what you're saying, and it's very perceptive. It's just, it's a part of the, you know, I mean, I don't do anything that's, I find surfing to not be that scary, but I don't surf pipeline because it's not, I find like snowboarding to be much scarier because it's hard objects and it's trees and other people, but I find, I don't.
She may be picking up on the determination of Anne-Marie's character because she.
No, but she's making a point of other people right, continually just telling her, just get over it, it's in your head, it's in your head,
but
and it's not.
I think that today, if the film were made, some of the points that you're talking about would be addressed. I think that it was 20 years ago. I think that now, thank goodness, a lot of people are more aware and a lot of people do have these conversations. And there are more sensitivities, I mean, in the mainstream public, and that sort of awareness does put more pressure on Hollywood, whether they want to do things the right way because they should or because they feel like they need to because of the audience. So I think that there might be, I think that those considerations would be addressed if the film were made today.
And I will say the surfing industry and in a hardcore sport like that, they are incredibly insensitive.
Right.
It's very true to the culture. And it's definitely just growing up as a surfer, like nobody was coddled ever, ever. Like, and so for better or for worse, I mean, a lot of, you know, issues come out of that because of the harshness. And so, you know, there's a lot of, you know, addiction and drug abuse that comes out of that, that people, because they can't really have their feelings heard because it's like, oh, you're just a pussy, get back out there, you know? And really if feelings were more heard, and that's what I do think, like you see a lot of the anxiety come through in Anne-Marie's character, kind of like holding it together. And it was very true to the culture. And I think nowadays, to what Jessica was saying, I think now a lot more is being talked about. I noticed that, like, it's even in the parenting style. I mean, Keala's father was very, you know, like, get back out there. And that was just very common. And I think nowadays you don't see that nearly as much. I think everyone is a lot more sensitive to people's feelings and their emotions and, you know, that. But yeah, I understand that the feelings that come out of that, it is hard to watch sometimes not having the, you know, the feelings being addressed there.
And thank I think you. Also the, well, and one other thing, just the mental health that is talked about more openly with athletes now and giving athletes that sort of respect, you know, in all people, competitive athletes or not. And to the point of Keala as a, you know, real life character in the movie, you know, this is a woman who has, you know, almost gone blind, you know, gashes in her head. She's going back out. Some of that is self-imposed drive. Some of that is, you know, the way she was brought up. She was having to surf and contest with the boys because there weren't any girls' divisions. So she had to fight her way. You know, she's also was like gentle as a lamb, you know.
So. Heart of gold.
Yeah.
But yeah, back then, 20 years ago, the surfing industry was very hardcore. You're talking, you know, with pipeline and stuff like that. People that were approaching that wave, they're just, you know, if people were going to go for it. It was very, I mean, like I said, when I keep saying the word authentic, like the film was very authentic, what they portrayed for the culture of the North Shore and of Hawaii and the competition.
But I wonder what would have happened, Kate, because you never, you had some very close calls, but if you had really gotten caught going over the falls, hit your head on a rock, would you have gone back? I mean, it would be, the studio probably would have been like, you can't go back out. Like, it's a big question about how anyone.
She would have gone back.
Do you remember you wanted me to go back out after the little concussion scare?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't go back out that day.
Yeah. I'm saying the studio was very cautious, too, because I remember, I don't even remember the
they
movie,
hired me
the
a
Jay Moriarty movie, and the lead guy got caught inside of Mavericks. And he never went back in the water.
Yeah.
They were like, you're never going back. I can't remember the actor's name, but like, you're never going to go back in the water. It's too dangerous. And he was like, I never want to go back in the water. I was all good up to that point. I was at acting exercise. And once I realized how powerful it was, I'm done.
I think because I was an athlete growing up, like as much as it was a joke of saying to John, like I ride horses, I compete as a show jumper, and I've fallen so many times I can't count, and fallen into jumps on fences, trampled by horses, you know. So I think that there was, and I have such an athletic drive from that, and it is an individual sport, similarly to surfing, like you are competing for yourself. I think there was a lot of that in me that sort of added to the character. So, I mean, the first time I was on a horse, I got kicked off. I was 6 years old, and the only thing I wanted to do was get back on, you know? So I don't know if I'd fall in a pipe and hit my head on a rock, but yeah. I don't know. I have that drive for sure.
Yes, you do. Do you have a question?
Yeah, so hi, I'm Michelle. So my question for you is, whenever I watch sports movies like this, I'm always going, okay, what is really the actor and what is the stunt double? So my first part is, first of all, what was your learning to surf experience?
Yeah.
And then how much was it really, did we see you surfing on screen?
Well, truly, the first time I learned to surf was true. It was for the audition, really. I had auditioned for John and Brian like 3 or 4 times, right? Like reading scenes.
Yeah, in an office.
In an office. I'd come, I wanted this so bad. I mean, I was like a.
Classes with Jonathan Paskowitz?
Yeah.
From the Paskowitz family. So she was doing one of the Paskowitz and then. Turtle. What's his real
name? Turtle.
Yeah. She was doing turtle classes. She was like getting every high profile surf teacher to teach her.
Yes. But
that we weren't funding or financing totally on our own.
Yeah, I mean, because I wanted the role so badly, you know? I mean, and I was pretty blunt in saying, like, why can I not have this role? Because because it was, like, clearly, I think John and Brian even said, like, you clearly have an affinity with this person. Like, it was clear. So, but obviously one of the skills that is required is surfing. So, unfortunately, you won't be able to have the role. And then that's when I hired a surf instructor, unbeknownst to them. And then about a month later, I think, a couple weeks later.
Yeah, we did surf auditions in Brian's house in the Melville Colony.
Oh,
sorry, Brian, at the Melville Colony. And it was
so many people.
Jessica Biel, Kate Bosworth. It was a bunch of talented actresses. And Kate got the role.
I was just the crazy one. I think I was the craziest of them all.
Bazon had such a hard time in the water. He did not
like the
water.
Like, he was so scared of sharks.
Yes.
He was convinced sharks were everywhere.
You were like water in the sea. Like, sharks cannot swim in. They're not. And if they get in, they're tiny. Yeah.
But then after I got the role, the training, a lot of what you see in the movie, like my training, I remember John would just like have a camera, go shoot her. And I remember, you know, people would say, but she's not in costume. And he'd be like, doesn't matter. No one's going to really, it doesn't matter. I'll use it somewhere. And so like so much of what you see is like what my training was, whether it was rock running or running the beach, or I had a bit of weight training, but it was really like 7 hours a day in the water surfing with the best, you know, water people in the world.
We put about 10 pounds of muscle. I mean,
20.
Yeah, you've had a lot. I mean,
But the short answer to your question is, anything of Kate paddling in the water in the lineup is Kate. Some of her surfing is Rochelle Ballard. And then some of it is, most of it's Rochelle.
Yeah.
And some face replacement.
Okay, one or two more questions? You? Oh, hello.
Yes, hi.
Use the mic.
I have a question for John. Since you did such a great job on this movie, I was wondering if you would ever consider either remaking Christine or doing a prequel or sequel or series about, since people are thirsting for 1980s nostalgia.
I think someone's making a Christine sequel. I forget who, but it's being made.
Oh, is
I'm
it?
Not involved okay. with it, but yes. It. And I don't know that
would
John Carpenter's in not involved.
Huh? Would you star in it or?
No, I don't think anyone's asking me. They didn't ask me that directly. Not in Top Gun 2 either.
All right, thank you.
You right there?
Yeah, so I was 18 when this movie came out, and I was a competitive high school swimmer, and then I went to college on a scholarship. Then I dated a surfer, and I remember him telling me, oh, just swim on the sand and watch me. And so this movie, when it came out, like, inspired the shit out of me.
Fans, right? Do you have people that, no matter where you are, they come up and they talk about Blue Crush?
Yeah.
How does that feel? Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I mean, it's such a huge honor. Yeah. You know, I think we all made this movie and with so much heart and like real commitment, but I don't think we knew. We couldn't possibly have known the sort of ripple effect it would have. And so when I have, you know, people my age who are now mostly moms and now their daughters, you know, coming up to me and saying, like, this is such a huge inspiration to me. It's like, that's like the dream, you know, to be able to be a part of something that moves people and inspires people. So it's a huge honor for me.
Well, any more questions? Oh, why am I here?
What are some of your favorite lines?
Oh, I was just saying one of the hardest lines for me to say was to Michelle when she's in the beginning when she's like sanding the board and I say, "Want to get wet?" That was a tough one. I had to commit. I'd really commit to that.
Yeah, there's some cringy lines.
I know one of the Kayala's.
Yeah,
that was funny.
Your little hooch.
Little hooch.
I was gonna say one of Kayala's favorite lines, even though she doesn't say it, is when the locals when the guys roll up and they're like, "We grew here, you flew here." Kayala loves to repeat that line. She like cracks up every time.
You and Matt had some great lines about falling in love with that girl. And I mean, it was really amazing how you still had your empowerment through the romance of the film. I think a lot of people talk about that.
I really loved the line. And I remember this line resonating with me when I read the script. And it was something like, when he says, "What do you want?" And my character says, "You know, I'd love to be on the cover of Surfer Magazine, but if it's not me, any girl would do." And that line really jumped out at me when I read it, and sort of still, I think that's kind of the thing that's part of the heartbeat of the movie that resonates with so many women, you know, is that it's the collective, it's the support, it's that matters.
Yeah. Well, I'm interested. Okay, one last question right here.
So, John, who is your technical filmer for all the underwater scenes? Because those of us concerned know that visceral feeling of getting sucked back over the wall.
John King.
And he did some really good, somebody
shot. John King did a lot of it.
I mean, that's Mike Stewart, actually. Because Mike Stewart is the guy that gets in the impact zone, and he's the guy that Don King is amazing, and he's a water polo guy, and he can swim like a fish, and he's just, what I learned from Don, I'd be like right next to him, and I'd be like, Don, shoot. He goes, no. Because you gotta remember, we had 200-foot loads, he's shooting 100 frames a second, or 200 frames a second. He had a minute 30 seconds of film. And this is obviously before video. So he would go out and it would take him 30 to 45 minutes to reload his camera, untape it, undo the water housings. So he would just know when not to shoot, which is such a skill set that so many photographers, cinematographers don't have today with digital. You know, they're just shoot, and they'll figure it out in the editing room. His great skill set was knowing, like I said, when not to shoot. So he would literally, Wave of little. I was like, oh my God, you just missed it. He's like, nope. And like 20 minutes later, just a set wave. And if he had shot those early waves, he would have been on the beach and missed it.
And so, he's so mellow. He's like, no.
Yeah, he's mellow guy. But it was, Don was doing a lot of like stuff on the channel. Mike Stewart was doing everything in the impact zone and a lot of the underwater stuff. Dave Holmesy. It was like a collection of Hawaiian guys. Like, nobody from Hollywood.
You weren't going on like, okay, I need some shots of somebody getting sucked back over.
You couldn't choreograph anything. I mean, half the time, like Coco Ho was the young Anne-Marie getting tumbled, and that was Brian. And it felt a little abusive because she was maybe 8 years old, and we were like throwing her into the backwash, but brought Brian Kailana and her mom and Eddie, Michael Ho, Senator Dad, Michael Ho, he was like, it's fine, she's used to it. Like, so they gave us permission and she would come up laughing all the time and never looked scared. But it was, I doubt that a traditional, you know, Hollywood production would allow you to do that.
No.
Okay, one more.
This is more of a thank you than anything. I have a daughter, and to give the present that you ladies have given to the surfers of women, because we always do the men surfers, and I say there's four movies that have done justice to surfing, and for you ladies to have done what you have done for our girls for surfing, I just want to more thank you. So,
guys, for coming. This is really awesome. I haven't seen this film. I haven't sat down and watched it. I mean, I think we were saying like in 10 years. So to be able to be here and share this night with you guys, I really appreciate it. This is really,
really
beautiful.
Special. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Carly.
Thank you, Carly.
Carly. Yeah, we need to thank Carly. She organized all of this. Yeah. Carly. I mean, she tracked us all down. You're awesome.
We just wanted to give you an award, our Industry Impact Award, because I think this crew of people deserve it for OIFF. We always have an Industry Impact Award.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming, everyone. Awesome.